I'm at college, but I went to school for a very long time to do that. How do I get this?
Oh, the PowerPoint?
The board froze.
It's hard if we can't get it. So two reasons why I'm here. Number one is to encourage you, especially those of you that are interested in agriculture, kind of get a game plan in place. I'll, you know, share a couple of the growing industries and jobs in agriculture. So it's not just farming and traditional farming. Many of you might think of traditional farming, but I'll share some other jobs that are growing, and my hope is to get more people interested in agriculture. I'll also share a little about what we do at Andrew College. How many of you are familiar with regenerative farming? Anyone? Anyone? What about sustainability, sustainable farming, sustainable agriculture? Anyone heard of that? Okay, not too many people. So that's a little bit about what I will talk about. I'd like you, does everyone have a pencil or a pen? Because I'd like you guys to check off that worksheet I gave you. So I want you to look at those labels. There's kind of some food buzzwords and food labels on there. You've probably heard of some of them. Maybe others you haven't heard of. Organic is on there, I think. So on that worksheet, I want you to kind of check off if you're familiar with it. If you haven't heard of it, you can check off not sure, you're not familiar with it. The other ones, I want you to kind of give me your first perception of it. Do you think it's a good, marketable product? If you walk into the grocery store, what grocery store do you guys have here?
Walmart.
Walmart? You shop at Walmart? Any of you actually do grocery shopping yourselves?
No. It's a grocery store.
I never went to the grocery store when I was in high school. But if you see one of those labels on a product, I want you to kind of check off what's your perception of it. Is it a positive, healthy choice for you to purchase? Does it kind of give you a bad feeling? I just kind of want you to, okay, there's no right or wrong answers, but take a minute or two to fill that out while we get started here. And again, the only reason you need to put your name on it is if you want more information about our program at Andrew College. So I'll talk about what regenerative actually is, but I'll give you a minute to finish that. So, what are you guys thinking so far? Are you familiar with some of these? Have you bought any of these before?
Yeah, I bought some of
them. Fruit? Have any of them had those labels on? You recognize any of them? Which labels have you guys seen on there?
Gluten-free.
Gluten-free? Have you bought gluten-free? Have you eaten gluten-free stuff?
In series.
What does gluten-free mean?
It has no gluten.
Okay, and what's gluten? Anybody know?
Yeah, like sugar.
Why? Let me ask this question. Why do people like gluten-free?
Because they say it's calorie.
Because they're
I think it's
healthier maybe.
Lactose intolerant.
Healthier maybe, yeah.
Because they're lactose intolerant.
Not lactose, that's in dairy.
It's not like they can't eat yeast or something.
Yeah, so gluten is a protein and wheat. You don't want to eat gluten if you have an allergy. I will mention, I think the latest statistic is only 2.5% of our population is allergic to gluten. So I don't know why so many people buy gluten-free, because not that many people actually have an allergy to it. But I'll talk a little about some of these brandings. From a farmer perspective, these are important. Whether or not you care about the health impact or the environmental impact, if you can slap one of these kind of labels on your product, assuming it's a good label, you're gonna make more money. Okay, so if I try to sell you a bag of chips and it doesn't have this label on it, how much does a bag of chips cost?
$125.
If I put an organic label on there and legitimately put it on there, people are willing to pay more money for something organic. So whether or not you care about the environment or your health or anything, from a farmer perspective, that makes sense, because these kind of mark these are marketable brands that you can put on there. Now, organic farming is not cheap. It is expensive in a lot of ways, just from the certification. But I spend a lot of my introduction, my introductory courses in agriculture, focusing on these kind of ideas and the production standards that go with them. So we get kind of a familiarity. I have a lot of kids, you know, in college don't understand all these. But that's what we kind of get into. What about GMOs? Has anyone heard of GMO? This one right here says non-GMO. You guys know what GMO stands for? There you go. So I'm going to give you a pin for a prize. You can do more homework. So I'm going to ask a couple questions, hopefully keep you guys thinking as I go through. Don't tune me out just yet, but we'll look at some of these labels and what they mean. Look at these, this ingredient list here. What are some of the things you see in there?
Water, sugar,
fruit, okay.
Fatty acids. Would any of you guys buy this product if it had these ingredients in it?
Yeah.
Too much toxic.
Okay. Show of hands. Who feels comfortable buying this product?
Who asked you to read it?
Any
exactly.
Question? Okay. Hands down. Who has kind of questionable about would you eat this product?
I would eat it.
The rest of you are on the fence. You don't really have an opinion. That's fair. Okay. Anyone have a guess what this is?
Cereal.
You know what it is?
Maybe a soft drink.
No, it's not a drink.
Is it a chip?
No, not chips.
Soda?
No.
It's not drink.
It's not a drink.
Let me give you the answer. It's a banana. Okay, so it's kind of a trick question. The reason that I'm mean to you guys, I do the same thing to my college students. They get tricked up on this kind of stuff too. Don't just take things for face value, okay? And I think these food labels are important because even this, it just kind of gives you a feeling. A lot of people have a negative feeling about this because it has things like glycine in it. Glycine's not bad necessarily. These different acids are not bad. It's a natural, you know, this could be an organic grown banana. It's important that whether or not you go into agriculture or traditional farming or sustainable farming, regenerative farming, it doesn't matter. You don't even have to work in that industry, but this is useful information as consumers. We all eat food. We don't want to put things into our body that are going to kill us. Not that a bag of chips is going to kill us necessarily. But I want you guys to be educated about these kind of things. Don't just take things for face value. You know, I'm not against gluten-free products like I was talking about a minute ago. Gluten-free has some benefits. People, especially with allergies to gluten, they're going to want gluten-free products. But I want you to understand why you're doing that, especially if you're paying more money for it, if you don't need to. Now, have y'all heard of the 2050 challenge? Talked about that? What's the 2050 challenge?
Eat 20% less food for the next 50 years.
Well, that's a good guess, but no. 2050 challenge just means the population's growing. By the year 2050, there's going to be a lot more people on the planet, so there's a big push. How are we going to feed more people? So people have babies. I don't want to give you guys that talk today. Hopefully you know that already, but people are having more babies within 50 years, give or take. What's the world population right now? Anyone know?
Dude, we just did that. 7 billion?
Yeah, a little over 7 billion.
It's over 7 billion.
So about 7.5 billion people. Well, in the next 20, 30 years, this says 50 years, we're going to have a lot more people on the planet. Some people say 9 or 10 billion people. So we don't have enough food to feed them, and that's kind of leading into what I'll talk about in sustainability. I hope you're at least a little familiar with sustainable farming. We'll tie that in with regenerative as well. But this is one aspect of it. We need more people working in agriculture, coming up with innovative ideas to produce food. I'm not going to show you guys a lot of data here, but you know, this isn't real data anyway, but you can look at this trend. Population is going up, so people are having babies. And one of two things can happen. Either when you run out of food, if we're not farming enough, then one of two things can happen. The most the most probable case is when we run out of food, we start dying, okay, and the population drops. That happens with animals all the time. So why wouldn't it happen with people? If we don't have enough food to feed people, that's what happens. Hopefully no one wants everyone to die. So the other option is to go more sustainable. We find out some technologies, some new systems, new ways to grow food, and that's really what, it's kind of the heart behind my work is being more sustainable and producing food in sustainable ways. So when you think of regenerative agriculture, it goes a little bit further than that. We'll talk about that, but that's really what sustainability is. Have you seen a diagram like this before?
Yeah.
You know what kind of diagram this is called? You want to take a math class? I think you do this in math class. Maybe not. I don't know. It's a Venn diagram. Anyway, I go by three different tenets, and this is kind of what I teach in agriculture at Andrew College. I go by the three P's, so it's easy to remember: people, profit, and planet. And you don't want to go too far in any one direction. If all you care about is the planet and you're a crazy hippie person, I might look like a hippie, your teacher might look like a hippie, but I don't know if you are a hippie.
Yes.
Okay.
Not cool.
I'm not a hippie. I grew up a vegetarian. My mom was a hippie. I had my first hamburger when I was 18 years old, and I've never looked back. I don't hold it against her, but no, I would never go back to being a vegetarian myself. I'm fine if she wants to do it, but I can't do it. But anyway, I do care about the planet still, and I think all of us should, whether or not we're farming or any industry that you work in. You're going to hear anybody, even if you work for, you know, Ford Motor Company, they're going to be concerned about sustainability and are they damaging the environment. Now, part of that is the government's going to fine you if you pollute the environment. So you want to care for the environment. You want people to have equality. You want to have equal payment for people. You want to have equal rights. You want to have equal access to food. So some parts of the world don't have access to food. Some parts of Georgia and different counties in Georgia don't have access to food, and others do. So this is another aspect of sustainability. And then profit. A lot of people think that sustainable agriculture or regenerative farming has no focus on profit, but that would kind of be dishonest. If you are not making money at doing something, you're not going to do it. And you need to make enough money, and not just break even. You need to, you know, make a little bit more money to keep your company going. So let me distinguish at this point the difference between sustainable farming and regenerative farming. And I'll talk about it from an economic standpoint. Let's say you sell all of your fruits and vegetables and you make $1,000. But then the next day you have to buy fertilizer and pay your water bill, and that's all $1,000. How much profit did you make? If you made $100 and then you spent $100, how much profit did you make?
Zero.
Okay, everyone got that math? Mm-hmm. It's not rocket science, but that is breaking even. And you could say the same thing about the environment. Well, I didn't pollute it too much. You could say the same thing about social equity. You don't want to just break even. Sustainability is not bad, but it's breaking even. Regenerative farming, you're actually having a net increase across all these spectrums. So profit, again, if you sell your product to make $1,000, well, in regenerative farming, the idea would be you're making a net positive return on that. That now you, let's say you, you're actually making $500 because your inputs aren't as high. You don't have a high water bill if you do regenerative farming. You don't have a lot of synthetic chemicals. So you're actually doing a net positive. That's also an impact on the planet, where you're improving the planet, getting a better quality out of the water, out of the soil, all those factors. I'll give you some examples of what this looks like. Has anyone heard of this guy, Norman Borlaug? You talked about him at all? Okay, so Norman Borlaug is this old guy credited with the Green Revolution. Anyone know about that?
I've heard of it. Not nothing that
I've doubted. Okay. So his idea, he recognized way back in the 1950s or sometime back then, he recognized that there was a problem, that we didn't have enough food to feed people. So he started doing those GMOs, changing the DNA in plants to get higher production. I think it's very good in that sense that food was produced more. Can y'all make out this picture down here? Anyone know what plant that is? It's wheat. So on the left hand, is wheat before this guy came around, what it looked like before he came around and genetically modified it. So on the left hand side, this DNA never hadn't changed yet. After he changed the DNA, it was much fuller, a lot more food. So he produced a lot more food just by altering the DNA there. I've given one example here, you know, corn production in that time from similar activities increased 292%. So some of this technology came about starting back in the 1950s. There are a few problems with it. It wasn't just this miracle growth stuff. These GMO seeds are very expensive. We still use them widely today on conventional farms. The seeds are not cheap. You have to water them a lot. You have to use a lot of chemicals oftentimes. It's kind of a package deal. It's a very expensive monetarily and as well as environmentally. I'm not going to discredit him for producing more food because that was very necessary. But at the same time, it's not necessarily sustainable. Y'all guys eating any of these? This is just one company. I'm not going to pick on Kellogg's, but I guess I will pick on Kellogg's. But guys eating these things today? I think I may have.
Today?
Oh, man.
I see you're not up here. I haven't eaten a
lot of fruit pills in
there. I had Kellogg's tonight.
You know what's similar between all of these? All, other than it's all made by the same company. But
cinnamon.
What do they all have in them?
Hey,
GMO. Okay. Obviously, they have a lot of stuff in common, but they do. They're all GMOs. They're all coming from a plant that's been genetically modified. So it's really hard to avoid it. You see those labels, non-GMO. They're not as common to come around those kind of things. But these are not. These have GMOs in them. So if you're trying to avoid GMOs, you'd want to avoid those. And I may have asked this earlier, but why don't we like GMOs? Let's assume we don't like GMOs, because people do pay more money for non-GMO. Why don't we like them?
They've been genetically modified. They're not the same.
They're not organic.
They're not organic, but what's the concern over it?
It's
not healthy.
Are there different chemicals in
it? They may have chemicals on them, yeah. I'm going to be honest with you, I don't really see that many documented cases of people getting sick from GMOs, but the GMO issue is primarily, from what I've seen, an issue with the environment. That if you go and plant something out in your garden or on your farm and it's GMO, you don't really know what's going to happen once it starts to grow. So, you know, there's a lot of caution when you start planting GMOs. I'm not sure it's so much a health issue. A lot of people make it out to be a big health issue. It may prove to be a legitimate concern. We just don't really see that many cases of, or any cases of people getting sick from GMO food. So I'm not a big, like I said, I'm not a crazy hippie. I don't just take things at face value. I don't really see a whole lot of health concerns with GMO. I'm fine if you want to exercise care with it. My wife is opposed to all these kind of things. I argue with her on a lot of these kind of things. One of the things is I just don't want to spend more money on expensive food, but the other option is you can make food yourself. But anyway, don't take things for face value. This is a picture from down by my mom's house in Florida. So what do you see in this picture? Okay, this is the St. John's River, and there's a lot of algae growing in it. Do you know why that algae is in the river, how it got there? Pollution from where?
Farm.
Yeah, she lives, it's actually in a town called Orangedale. There's no more oranges there. I don't know why they, I guess they still call it Orangedale because it has a history. It's all potato farms now. So mostly potato farms, there's other stuff out there too, but all the fertilizer they use ends up going into the river. So they use a lot of fertilizer, a lot of chemicals. It ends up in the water, it kills the fish, so you can't go fishing out there. I mean, you can go fishing, but it's kind of scary to eat stuff when it's looking like that. You can't swim in there. Legally you can't swim in there at certain times of the year. So this is some of the issue, just to give you an example of the environmental side of it. I know I kind of highlight the profit aspect, but the environment will also deteriorate. Now, you won't necessarily get fined. The government's not going to fine you for this because they can't really track where it came from. But maybe you don't feel so ethical about that, polluting the waterway in that manner. Have you guys purchased organic food? Anybody? Nobody?
Yeah, I do.
What kind of organic? What did you buy that was organic? Fruit? Vegetable? Meat? What do you guys know about organic?
I mean, it's natural. Grown.
It's healthy?
Grown naturally.
I drink organic
organic grape juice? Okay. So yeah, your guys are a little bit familiar with that. It is grown naturally, but what does naturally mean? For an animal product, you can't use hormones or antibiotics in it. You can't use genetically modified organisms. You can't use synthetic chemicals. And I think you guys have a good instructor to kind of lead you in that direction. But I'll again go back to the profit aspect of it. If you can get certified organic, you're going to sell your product for higher value. So we partner with Andrew College, where I teach. We partner with White Oak Pastures. Has anyone heard of it?
Yeah.
Okay, so they do a lot of organic meat and fruit and vegetables. So all their products are organic. People pay more money for it. It doesn't really sell that well in Southwest Georgia, but he does a lot of sales in Atlanta and Columbus and some of the bigger cities. There certainly could be some health aspects. I won't say 100% of organic products are healthier. Some products may be kind of standard with conventional, but for the most part, yeah, you'd get a healthier product, or at least expect to get a healthier product from organic production. On the left-hand side is a Dirty Dozen list. On the right-hand side is the Clean 15. So if you are concerned about buying GMO food or food that has chemicals on it, you'd probably want to be careful with these. So on this left-hand side, let's look at this first one, apples. If you are concerned about chemicals being on your food, you'd probably want to buy organic apples because they usually have a lot of chemicals on them. Same thing with celery, cherry, tomatoes. All of these on the left-hand side typically have more chemicals on them. So if you're concerned about chemicals, you'd want to buy this side, you want to buy it organic. That way you're not getting those chemicals. My favorite fruit is a mango. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, mango's in Clean 15, so I can save some money there. I don't have to buy that organic. That's why I kind of talk about with my wife. She wants to buy everything organic. I let her kind of buy more of the organic stuff off this side, especially for our kids. Pesticides won't. If you eat a conventional apple, you eat just a regular old apple, you're probably not going to drop dead from the pesticides on it. At least with my children, they're pretty small, so I usually pick off, conventional, I use this, but I'll buy these things organic. Of course, that's just a consumer decision, but people are spending more money on organic because of that. A couple other things happened recently. Going from 1950s on, we started increasing animal products as well. Y'all seen this picture before?
15% of our chicken was that big.
Was that chickens?
That like
yeah, the same same age. So those chickens are the same age. This was the average size back in 1957. That's more recent. So what made those chickens larger?
Steroids.
Steroids? Yeah, so we're putting hormones in them. That brings me to another point, though. Yeah, so have y'all seen, I've seen this before, you buy chicken at the grocery store and it'll say hormone-free on it. Have you seen that?
Yes.
Like no hormones? Because the problem I have with that is that you're not legally allowed to use hormones in chicken anyway. So why put it on there? Any chicken you buy is not going to have hormones in it, so what's the point of that label? I don't know. That's just a side point. But yeah, we use a lot of hormones and a lot of antibiotics in it, so this doesn't fall within the organic framework. And a lot of our regenerative farming at Andrew College and White Oak Pastures, we're using an organic framework, less chemicals, more natural ways to do that. So they do a lot of poultry production at White Oak Pastures. We don't have animals walking around our campus. We have them at White Oak Pastures. They don't use those kind of things, so their chickens might be a little bit smaller. They're really concerned with animal welfare. All their animals are pasture-raised and can go have a higher standard of living. What's your guys' favorite restaurant?
Chick-fil-A.
Okay. Chick-fil-A. So Chick-fil-A gets a B on this breakdown for their use of antibiotics. So they're pretty good. They're avoiding antibiotics for the most part. I don't think Subway made it on here, but Subway's in a big transition to use more.
So the one in the F category means they use
antibiotics. So their meat products their animals have been treated with antibiotics to promote growth mainly. So hormones and antibiotics. Hormones are only used to make the animals bigger. Antibiotics at least have some benefit for health purposes, but the reason people use hormones and antibiotics is to get a bigger animal or more production. So, again, if you're concerned about those kind of things, you know.
Is that a good thing or a bad thing?
Antibiotics. So what's the downside of antibiotics? Anyone know? I mean, if I get sick, I'm going to use antibiotics, to be honest.
They ain't going to work
for you. If you're not sick,
yeah. If you're not sick, there's no point in antibiotics. So what's the problem with antibiotics in our meat? Let's say they're just using antibiotics. Let's say, look at, Subway. Okay, so right now Subway has an F. They're working on improving that. But Subway right now uses a lot of antibiotics in their meat products. What's the problem with that? Any guesses? So it should make you healthier, right? Because it's got antibiotics in it. No. So the FDA, let me say this. Yeah, it's a health concern, but not because of the chemical, not because of the antibiotic. The FDA very tightly regulates the antibiotics and makes sure that none of it's in it by the time it gets on your plate. So there's a certain dosage time for the antibiotics. You can't kill the animal if there's antibiotics still in it. That's very tightly regulated. So really there's no concern over the antibiotics. The concern with the antibiotics, people pay for antibiotic-free because of the superbugs that it develops. So you get these really strong bacteria and things that become resistant to the antibiotics, and that'll come along with the meat. So it's kind of a side effect. It's not the antibiotics that's hurting you. If you did directly consume them, it would make you sick. But there's no antibiotics in any food. There shouldn't be, because the FDA looks at it. But it's the bacteria that it strengthens. So when you eat bacteria like that, you end up with some issues. Does that make sense?
Yeah, so the ones at the bottom, like the F category, so they need to do better with the antibiotics, pretty much.
Yeah, so, you know, Pizza Hut, all these down here with S. You're not concerned about eating the antibiotics in these foods, in these restaurants down here, but you're concerned about the bacteria that could be in it because they're really, really resistant. So then if you get sick and you take an antibiotic, the doctor gives you a prescription, it's not going to do anything because you have this, like, super virus in you.
I can't believe it. No.
Who?
Now.
I don't even eat McDonald's. I just think they're meat products.
Now, again, I eat at these restaurants. I do it, so don't think I'm like, just point my finger at anybody. Look at this, me, on the, you know, left, me on the right. One of them is grass-fed beef, and the other is grain-fed beef. Anyone know which is which?
The one who gets grain got the most fat on.
Grain has the most fat? Which one has the most fat?
The one on the left. Yeah.
Okay, so the one on the left has more fat, and you say it's because it's been grain-fed? Yeah, you're right on that. So grain-fed beef typically has more fat. Based on that information, which one's healthier for you?
Grass-fed.
Okay, because you want to avoid the fat. I mean, back in the day, you know, 50 years ago, people liked fatter meat like that, but now we buy more lean meat. Okay, so that would be on the right-hand side of grass-fed, you get a healthier meat out of it, among other things. But that's, again, what we focus on as part of our animal production, animal science side of things at Andrew College is moving towards more grass-fed products. What about cage-free? Have you guys seen cage-free when you buy eggs? Sometimes a carton of eggs will say cage-free on it. Yeah, so I'll be honest with you though, cage-free, I've got a little bone to pick with that because if you are concerned about animal welfare, you certainly don't want to lock a chicken up in a cage. Some of you might not have a problem with it, but if you're concerned about the animal welfare, you say, oh, cage-free sounds great. But really, it only means they have to be given a square foot of space. That's not very big. It's like one of these square tiles on the floor. So a square foot of space, although cage-free sounds pretty good, I prefer the chickens have a little bit more space. I mean, that's kind of a misleading thing. It doesn't mean antibiotics weren't used. Antibiotics can be used in those animals. They don't have to have any access to outdoors. So some of these labels, again, you have to be careful. My wife, for a number of years, she bought cage-free eggs thinking that it was like healthier, that it was you know, better to eat cage-free eggs, it was better for the chickens, but it's not necessarily true. Okay, it might be better than nothing, but a better standard would be pasture-raised. So pasture-raised chicken obviously has the most access to outdoors and can stretch its legs. This chicken was caged, given antibiotics a lot. This is like, I think like 4 weeks later after it was pasture raised. So they transitioned it from a cage to a pasture. Obviously its health started doing a lot better. So I would say maybe a chicken, not all chickens are gonna look that bad. But even a cage-free chicken could look like that. A cage-free chicken could look like that because it still only has 1 square foot of a room to walk. That's really not enough room to walk, hardly turn around. So cage-free, maybe not so good. But I encourage you, you know, I can't talk about all these today. I encourage you, if you have any interest in these things, even from a consumer standpoint, to look at them on your own. And there is a difference in the product that comes out of it. A lot of people do prefer the creamier pastured egg that comes out of that chicken compared with the conventional. So, you know, we focus on both plant and animal production at Andrew College. We do a lot of hands-on activities. I'll give you guys a little quiz. Let's see, rainfall and irrigation. That's basically your two methods for watering your plants. In the United States, which one do you think we do more of?
Irrigation.
Rain or irrigation?
Irrigation.
Think we do more irrigation?
In Georgia.
In Georgia? Actually, 94% of our farmland, and this includes not just fruit and vegetables, but 94% of our farmland in the U.S. is actually rain-fed, which is a good thing. I mean, it's cheaper for one. You don't pay anything for rain.
It usually is really rare that it rains.
This is real expensive. What's that?
I said it's really rare that it rains. So.
Yeah, that is a big risk.
I'm saying the rules are not.
Well, I don't know. You know, our farm that we work with down in Bluffton, Georgia, White Oak Pastures, they don't have any irrigation systems like this. So last year we had a drought, you know, they made it through pretty fine. I mean, there's a lot of things that you can do, especially if you have a healthy soil. If you have water in your soil, you'll make it through a drought. So that's kind of a balance. It is a gamble, I'll admit. It's pretty scary, but this is also very expensive equipment to run and to buy it. And you don't necessarily have to do it. Obviously, 94% of our farms are getting away with it without using that. Now, here's, again, another irrigation system. So this is on a farm. And this is kind of the city aspect. So you think about all the water that we use in our house, flushing the toilets, taking showers, washing dishwashers, washing machines. The industry companies, they use a lot of water as well. You look at any kind of paper processing mill or any industry, almost any industry uses water in the production system. But the interesting thing is 80% of our water use is from farming. Remember, let me go back. Okay, so our irrigation, I went too far back, our irrigation systems are only 6%, but that 6% of our farms are using 80% of the water. So that's pretty significant. The few farms that are using water, and I say few, but it is a lot, they're using 80% of our water use. So if more and more people start using and relying on irrigation on their farms, it's going to be a problem. Going to have water shortages and other issues with that. I teach from a perspective where we should use and rely on rainfall. I'm not saying everyone has to get rid of their irrigation systems, but use it sparingly. You know, if it's going to rain that day, you're not going to turn your sprinklers on. For one, you're just wasting money, but you're wasting water as well. Do you guys see the difference of this picture here? Okay. So what happened on the right side? You know what? You know what that farmer did. What do you see? What's the difference between left and right side?
I mean, the right side's cleaner than the left side.
Yeah, the right side's cleaner. Yeah. So the farmer went over this land and tilled it, turned the soil over. One of the things that does is obviously he's getting ready to plant stuff, getting ready to cultivate things. But we're seeing more and more people go to what you see on the left side. That's no tillage or zero tillage. I mean, they did not run the tiller over the ground. So you see more and more people doing this. This is what we teach at Andrew College. You know, of course, I have students now that want to do things conventionally. They want to do this. They want to do the massive tilling. I'm fine with if they want to run a tiller on their farm, but we teach from a perspective that we want to take care of the soil. So let's say it rains across this whole landscape, and then the sun comes out. Which one of these is going to dry faster? Okay, they're both wet to the same degree, and now it's evaporating. Which one is going to be dry?
Right.
Okay, this one on the right is going to dry out really quickly. And that's why you need more irrigation. Every decision that you make on the farm, kind of a domino effect. So you decide to till your land and get it ready, and it's easy just to sit around in a tractor and drive it back and forth and till your land, but you're hurting the soil and you're messing it up for you know on a tillage side. You mess the soil up, you're going to need more fertilizer when you plant. You're also going to need more water because it's going to dry out very quickly. So it has a lot of negative impacts. So again, it goes back to, you know, whether or not you care about the environment and stopping erosion and those kind of things, but it also comes back to the finances. If you till your land, you'll more than likely need more chemicals because the soil quality's gone down. This is more of a natural landscape. Obviously, it's not a natural landscape, but it's closer to a natural ecosystem because there's dead plants that are still on the ground. You leave those dead plants, it holds the water in the soil, you have a healthier soil, you have a healthier farm. We'll do a little experiment if I have time. But a lot of people also claim, you know, you get better products with no tillage. So these onions are a little bit bigger. The ones that have been tilled, the ground's been turned. And again, the soil is pretty much the basis of your plant production. So soil quality is very important. What the, you know, how much water you have, all those kind of things are important. Well, if you till your ground and destroy the soil, your product may not end up being that that great in the end. So there are some additional advantages as well.
The till is the one that was the right field, right?
The tillage is when it's been turned over. There's
the really dirty one.
So the other side had still had stuff from the previous year. Kind of leave it in the ground. You leave that stuff covering the ground. That way you protect the soil. It's kind of like leaving.
What happens when you want to plant something new?
You just go out there and plant it. It's not necessarily that you have to. Now sometimes you'll need.
Is it going to be like annual plants?
Yeah, I would say in line with this, the farms that are avoiding tillage, which what I would say was I would say that's a good decision to avoid tillage. You'll see them planting perennials as well and ground cover. You always want to keep your ground covered. Anytime the soil is exposed, that's time when you're losing nutrients in the soil. So plants, you know, you look in a natural environment, you go out in the woods around here, you see plants there year-round, okay? Trees may lose their leaves in the fall, but there's still activity happening. When you go out and till, you kill everything out there, even stuff in the soil. You kill everything when you run a tiller over the ground. So there's nothing going to grow there. You're depleting all your nutrients. So I would say you want to have at least some kind of ground cover. You want to have perennials. If you do an annual, it's not going to be that good. Okay, anyone know what this plant is on the left? Any guesses?
Peas?
Not peas, no. Anyone have a snack food? You got a snack food. I'm not going to pick on you for eating that, but read the ingredients on it.
Enriched cornmeal.
It's not corn, but yeah, good guess. You have any soybean oil? Yeah, these are soybeans. The reason I ask you to look at your label, and I would say all of you could do that at some point today, corn and soybeans, it's pretty hard to find a product without corn or soybeans. And the first ingredient on that is corn. I had a granola bar on the way here. It had corn and soybean oil in it. This is soybean oil. It's really hard to find a product without that. Again, a lot of these things like corn and soybeans are genetically modified, most of them that are planted. So this is a monoculture on the left-hand side. Why is it called a monoculture?
There's one thing planted.
What's that?
There's one thing that's planted.
Yes, one thing that's planted.
Ask him what the thing on the right is.
So what's that on the right?
I'm going to fail every one of you if you can't say it.
Okay, I heard somebody. So a monoculture, what's that? Latin, I never took Latin, but mono probably means one, poly means more than one. So they have a polyculture there. What's the advantage of a polyculture?
You can just plant more than just one thing.
You can what?
You can plant more than just one thing.
You can plant more than one thing. How does it help you as a farmer? Sounds like more work, to be honest.
So
more money?
More money? Could be. Help each other out?
Yeah, like you plant two plants on the side of each other. You
don't
have to
be
the side.
Yeah. Okay. All good answer. That's a really good answer. So yeah, you can diversify your product. Now you have, you know, here all you have is soybeans and maybe that's selling really good. You do have a diverse product here, you can sell different products. But the best aspect is an environmental aspect where, you know, soybeans are nitrogen fixing. They pull nitrogen into their root system. But what's putting the nitrogen back in? How do you put nitrogen back onto a farm like this?
We did that. Oh my God.
What's a farmer do?
Love.
Love.
That's just like water.
Love.
Nitrogen. Where does nitrogen come from?
Come on. Somebody.
comes from fresh cut grass.
Legumes.
He planted something else.
Yeah. And so, yeah, you can put different plants in here that put nitrogen back into the ground. So some plants use nitrogen, some put nitrogen back in. You get that kind of a system with a polyculture. Otherwise, you're going to need fertilizer. You're going to need to buy fertilizer. And we've already seen some of the dangers with more chemicals. I'm not completely against chemicals. Some people are going to use chemicals. I don't expect that tomorrow every farmer in the country will stop using chemicals. But I think for the better, if we start using it sparingly, I think we're going to have some positive outcome from that. So in a polyculture, you have a natural balance. You have more variety. Some plants are giving other plants nutrients and vice versa. A polyculture and how I integrate it into kind of a well-balanced perspective in my courses is I don't just talk about polyculture of plants, but also plants and animals. So we even do, in partnership with White Oak Pastures, we do, and what he does at his farm is rotate animals and plants together. So there's some benefit there between the plants and animals as well. So he has, you know, 12 different ruminant animals. He has a variety of plants growing. He's doing all together, and it's more of a natural balance like you see in a real ecosystem. Corn, I mentioned that. That's another big product. How much of our farmland, our cropland, do you think is devoted to corn growing? Remember, corn is almost in every product that we eat. Somebody have a guess on the percentage there?
75%.
It's actually not that high. Yeah, but a quarter. That's still pretty big. Think of all the different fruits and vegetables we grow in this country, but a quarter of them is devoted to corn. Now, how much fertilizer do we put on it? Okay. Almost half. Okay, almost half of our fertilizer in this country goes to corn, even though it's only a quarter of our growth. So corn, you know, again, this is a GMO plant. It doesn't mean you're using less fertilizer necessarily. You still use a lot of fertilizer on it. But these are really big products. Now, you can grow this in a polyculture. You can do it in a more sustainable framework. You can do it in an organic framework where you don't have to do that, but by and large, this is the way things are done in the country. Like I said, we keep animals and plants kind of together. That's more of a holistic framework where the plants benefit from having animals there and vice versa. So what do you do with the poop from an animal? When it poops, fertilize. Fertilize. Okay? So you use their manure, put it back on your farm. So that's how you feed the plants, and then they go and eat their own poop grass, and the cycle kind of continues. So let's look at this average size cow. How much poop do you think they make a day?
Maybe like 50%.
Hmm? Well, how many pounds?
How many pounds? Like 200, 300.
300 pounds?
Oh, it's all one cow. How many?
One cow.
Oh, one cow. I get like 150 to 100 pounds.
150 pounds, not that high, no.
25
pounds?
65
pounds.
I said
50. Would you say 60? I give you a prize for that. No, you want one too. 65 pounds. What about urine?
I give about two.
Two?
Five.
How many gallons? You fill two milk jugs, you think?
I give about three.
Three, four, it's like five. Maybe five. Yeah,
three or
four.
Four. Yeah. All right. Anybody else? Who said five?
Said two.
Okay. So that's a lot of waste. Let's say you had 100 head of cattle. Do the math on that. If you had 100 of these cows, how much poop would you have every day?
Too much.
6,500 pounds. So it's a big thing. You might not seem like that much for one cow, but most people have at least a medium-sized farm like that, 100 cows on it. That's a lot of manure. It'd be stupid not to use that, or at least to sell it to somebody else. That's going to cut out a big expense that you have, and manure is a more natural thing to put on your plants anyway. So again, that's kind of promoting from that aspect. Ruminant animals, you guys know what a ruminant animal is?
Like dogs.
No, not so. Yeah, I'll give you a hint, it's a cow. A cow is a ruminant animal. How many stomachs does a cow have?
Two, four.
More, four. Four stomachs.
Oh, yeah.
So a cow has four stomachs. It's a very specific type of animal called a ruminant animal.
They don't have four stomachs, they have four sections.
Four sections, yeah. They have one kind of true stomach, similar to ours. But a ruminant animal can eat grass. We can't eat grass. Do you know why? I don't think you should try to, because we can't. I mean, technically, yeah, you could chew it up and eat it, but you probably can throw up.
What is that?
So why can't, that's a cow drooling. Okay, I kind of drool like that sometimes when I eat too. But why can't we eat grass? Why can ruminants eat grass? So they can't break down the enzymes. Well, they chew the cut up, but they have a bacteria in their stomach, or in their four stomachs. The bacteria is what eats the grass. So we have bacteria in our stomach too. You know, a lot of people buy probiotics or eat things like yogurt and get probiotics in it to get bacteria, but it's a different bacteria. Ruminants have a special bacteria that breaks this down. But what I'm showing here, this ruminant, they chew grass up, and then they spit it back up, and yeah, and they swallow it again.
They just can't spit it up.
Back and forth, yeah. So they chew it up, regurgitate it, and swallow it back and forth. The whole time they're drooling like this. I'm going to say if you put a bowl under his mouth, how much saliva do you think you'd have at the end of the day?
Half a gallon.
Half a gallon?
Each day.
Every day. If you filled it up at the end of the day, let's see, put it in there in the morning, at the end of the day, how much?
Two.
Five? So let me give you this bit of information. They chew about 6 to 8 hours a day. How long is your lunch break here?
30 minutes.
30 minutes? So he's got a lot more time to sit around chewing. Okay. It's more than 2 gallons.
So I get about 8, 7.
Keep going higher.
12.
Higher.
15.
20.
Higher.
25.
50. 30. Yeah, about 50. So think of this, a standard trash can or recycle can like this is about 50 gallons. You could fill one of those up with saliva. So it's a very, ruminant animals are very messy.
It's kind of like wise
in that sense. So, you know, we talk about these technical aspects. We, at Andrew College, I teach those kind of technical perspectives in the classroom. We apply them in the field, in the garden side of things that we do on campus, and as well as at White Oak Pastures. But we also look at some of the social aspects as well. I was born outside of Atlanta. I lived in the suburbs. I grew up there. That is Atlanta. I don't like the traffic. I don't know if I'd ever live there again. How many of you guys expect to stay in this area, you know, later in life? Who wants to live in a city?
I could, dude.
Yeah.
I live in the city a lot. I like the lights at night. That's why.
Yeah, it's fun. You got activities there. It's not, you know, this kind of life is not for everyone.
I like the country life too.
Yeah. So, I'm going to challenge you guys though. Like I mentioned at the beginning, agriculture. There's so many different jobs and innovations in agriculture that you can even find farming and agricultural and environmental positions in a city environment. Of course, we do need farmers out in the countryside as well, but I'm not a traditional farmer myself. Most of my experience is in more urban settings and technology, sustainable agriculture. You know, as you guys heard of rooftop gardens and stuff like that, growing food on the roof, vertical hydroponics. There's a lot of stuff that's happening in the cities that
Mr. Bob?
Yes?
Please send a student to pick up a package for you.
Okay.
Also send my paperwork I need. This is William.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
So, right now about 62% of our population in the U.S. lives in a city. You know, think of places like Atlanta, Chicago. 62% of people live in the country, in the city. Over the next 30 years, that's going to increase. Most of our population, 80%, is going to live in the city because it's boring in the country, unless you know how to have fun. So even with that being said, though, there's still jobs in this sector. I'll highlight some of those later. This is Beijing, so an infrared image of Beijing. Where's Beijing?
China.
So here's what it looks like. This is downtown Beijing. That's why it's showing up in black. There's so many people there that's how the infrared camera worked. Now you go forward, this is in the year 2000. This is 9 years later, it expands. So it just demonstrates, I don't have images for like Atlanta or something, but the same kind of idea. Nobody wants to live in the country anymore. But we're going to have to get more innovative with agriculture there. If we have that many people, that many babies being born, we're going to have to come up with innovative technology to grow food for all those people, especially if they all live in the city. Let's look at gender equality. These are some more social issues that I'm kind of passionate about. But let's consider male and female. Do you think we have more male or female farmers in the U.S.?
Male.
How much? What do you think the percent? 51, 49? What?
About 60.
75, 25? Yeah, so about 30 to 70. Okay, I only have one girl in my program right now, and she's setting the curve. She's got the most experience, and she's actually applying herself really well. So women, they have to work hard to cut it, but it's a surprise that more women aren't interested in agriculture. In other parts of the world, women account for a higher percentage, but in the U.S., we do see a lot more men working in agriculture. This is a family in Chad, and this is their, where's Chad, anyone know? Yeah, in Africa, Central Africa. They spend $1.23 on their weekly groceries. You think you'd want to live there? Look at what they're eating. That's what they eat for the week. So I spend the same, all week for however many people that is. I spend about the same on a sandwich at McDonald's. So, that's like a dollar menu right there, but they're getting food for a week. I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time on this. This is from a book called Hungry Planet. Showing different families. So this is in Bhutan, that's in Asia. They have a lot of fruits, vegetables, and things like that. Ecuador, how many bananas they eat? Isn't that wild?
That's crazy.
Okay, they're still only spending $31. Anyone know how much they spend? You don't have to tell me, but.
Just all for a week?
Yeah, this is all just, 7 days worth of food with the. So here, I think they actually have a soda here in India, so it's getting a little bit more familiar to what we've seen. Here in Mongolia, now this, I wouldn't mind living in Mongolia, to be honest. They have a lot more meat. I don't know about these eggs, though. They got like 100 eggs right there in the middle of the table. Yeah, so they're eating a lot of protein, a lot of carbohydrates. I kind of like that diet. Egypt, okay, that's a ton of vegetables.
Vegetarian, right?
$8, yeah. Okay, here's the United States.
$341, dude.
Yeah, so we're almost spending 300 times more than Chad was. Remember, Chad just had some grain and stuff like that. I don't even think Chad had meat. So what do you guys see here? What are they eating? What's the main difference in
junk food, Roman food?
Eat everything.
Yeah.
Wavy legs.
Yeah.
They got Capri Sun sitting on top. Diet Coke. Then you got the Bill.
Pizza, McDonald's stuff, Taco Bell. So I'm not against all these things, but this is kind of the social aspect that needs to be addressed in terms of sustainability. And we're, as farmers, having to find creative niches in this. White oak pastures. You know, they produce fresh food as well as packaged food. So they sell to, has anyone heard of a paleo diet? Raw food or anything like that? So, So sometimes if you're doing like a P90X workout or something, people start eating paleo because it's all meat. You need a lot of meat a lot of protein. So, you know, you can buy snack food that's healthy for you. I don't see that highlighted a lot here. But yes, these kind of decisions, what consumers are buying, should affect a farmer's decision. So people are buying more organic products, they're buying more paleo diets. So we need to respond to that. How much time do we have left?
25 minutes.
Okay, so we're not the worst defenders here. Here's Germany, they spend $500.
They invite up a bill.
Yeah, so.
A little drinking product, pretty much. Really.
So yeah, they really don't have that much food. Say half of it is like a bottled beer or something.
The egg,
soda. But I think they even buy water. I don't think they drink their tap water there. I think most people drink bottled water. But yeah, they do have a lot of alcohol, and I have no idea what these are. But yeah, they're spending more than 400 times what Chad was. So there is some inequality there. So, keep this in mind, there's 7.5 billion people, but 1 billion people in the world are hungry, 24,000 people are dying of starvation. So why does that happen if countries like US and Germany have such excess? It really is a lot of inequality there. And I think a lot of it comes down to this kind of issue. This comment is kind of crude, but I think it depicts it well. So rich countries like this, we have so much food and we end up just throwing a lot of it away. We throw away about 40% of our food. I mean, that's what you do with your table scraps. I used to have a dog and I would give him my table scraps. Now I just throw it away. But we throw away 40% of our food. So, you know, this trickles down all the way to the farmer and his decisions in production. This trickles down to education, post-harvest production and processing, but a lot of moving components here to kind of resolve some of these inequality issues. Here's a question for you guys: tomato, is it fruit or vegetable?
Vegetable.
Fruit.
Okay, show of hands. Show of hands. Fruit. Two hands, not one hand. You don't know, okay. Okay, hands down. Who thinks it's a vegetable?
If it have a stem, what do you mean?
If it got a stem,
it's a fruit.